All right, so in today's video, we're going to be talking more about maximum and minimum values of a function of multiple variables. We're going to introduce a very nice, convenient test called the second derivative test to classify the critical points of a multivariable function as local mins, local maxes, or potentially saddle points, points which don't quite qualify as either a local min or a local max. And then we're going to be talking about what is the definition of an absolute maximum slash minimum of a multivariable function. So let's go ahead and get started. Let's introduce this second derivative test. So as always, I'm going to have a thought bubble over to the side where I remember back in Calc 1. Because in Calc 1, we introduced a lot of theorems that were really just extending, just generalizing now. So supposing that f prime of a was equal to 1 if f double prime of a was negative, x equals a gave us a local max. Because this essentially told us that the graph was concave down and resembled in many ways a parabola that opened down. And we had the statement that if f double prime of a was greater than 0, then x equals a was a local min. Because having a second derivative that was greater than 0 told us that the graph was concave up and to some extent resembled a parabola opening up. Now, for the second derivative test, we of course have to deal with the fact that we have really four different second derivatives. The fxx, the fyy, and the two mixed partial derivatives to deal with. And we have to account for all four of them to make sense of what might be called concavity for a function of two variables. So here is our theorem. This is the second derivative test for a function of two variables. Suppose that ab is a critical point of f of xy. So we're already assuming that the gradient vector is zero or undefined at that point. Suppose that the second order partial derivatives are continuous. This is just a bit of fine print to make sure that our function is nice enough to qualify to use the second derivative test. The first thing that you need to do in the test is you need to calculate this quantity called capital D. This D stands for something called determinant, I always get those mixed up. So if you have spent any time working with matrices, you've heard this term before. The determinant of a matrix, this is the determinant of a particular matrix that is filled up with second derivatives. Now, you calculate this quantity, which requires taking fxx, fyy, multiplying them together, and then subtracting fxy quantity squared. You have a couple of different cases. The first possibility is that when you calculate this number d, the result is negative. If you got a negative number, then that is a sign that ab is a saddle point. Yes, it's a critical point, but it's neither a local max nor is it a local minimum, sort of a fusion of the two. All right, the next thing that we're going to check is that number D positive? And if so, take a closer look at the second derivative in the x direction. If capital D is positive and the function is concave up in the x direction, this is a mnemonic that I use, cave up in x direction, then just as in the single variable case, we're going to get a local minimum at the point AB. Local minimum, the function being concave up in the x direction. But before we even look at f sub xx, we do need to check first of all that the determinant is positive, because if it's negative, then we have a saddle point and not a local minimum. Now, on the other hand, if your determinant is positive and you check f sub xx and you find that your function is concave down in the x direction, then you can say for sure that your point AB is a local maximum. Now, what about the final possibility? You know, we've dealt with d less than 0, d greater than 0, but what if your determinant is exactly 0? Well, then you're out of luck. Your second derivative test has not told you anything at all. You cannot make any conclusions. Anything is possible. You could have a saddle point, you could have a local min, you could have a local max. There's no way of knowing at this point. You would have to either look at the graph or maybe look at the contour map of the function. You would need some other way to classify the point because the second derivative test is inconclusive and it will not tell you anything. Okay, let's try it here. Find and classify the critical points of the function f of xy equals x to the fourth power, y to the fourth power, minus 4xy, plus 1. All right. So to find the critical points, we need to start by finding the first derivatives. So f sub x, by power rule, 4x cubed from the first term, nothing from the second term, minus 4y from the third term, nothing from the last term. F sub y, nothing from the first term, 4y cubed from the second, and then from the third, minus 4x, and then nothing from plus 1. Now, if I set both of these equal to 0, 4x cubed minus 4y, then this first equation tells me that y must be equal to x cubed. That way they'll cancel out. And if I take the second equation, set it equal to y, to 0, and I substitute in the data from the first equation, then this tells me that 4x cubed to the third power minus 4x is equal to 0. Okay, so what does this mean? This means that 4x cubed cubed x to the ninth power minus 4x is equal to 0, or 4x x to the eighth power minus 1 is equal to 0. Alright, so that means that either x is 0 or x to the 8th power is equal to 1. And there are only two real numbers whose 8th power is equal to 1. X could be positive 1 or x is equal to negative 1. Again, there are many more complex numbers which satisfy this equation, the so-called 8th roots of unity. But we are not considering complex numbers in these calculations. All right, so if these are the three possibilities for x, and y must be equal to x cubed, then the corresponding x would be 0 cubed, 1 cubed, minus 1 cubed. Okay, I don't have anywhere near enough space to finish this calculation. Hold on, we're going to get another page. So we have three critical points at the moment, CP, we have the point 0, 0, we have the point 1, 1, and we have the point minus 1, minus 1. Now in order to classify these points, we're going to use the second derivative test, which will require us to find all the second derivatives. So let's just quickly remind ourselves what f of x and f sub y were. 4x cubed minus 4y4y cubed minus 4x, and let's go about and find all the second order derivatives. So we have f sub xx. Well, I'll take the derivative with respect to x of this quantity. and we have 12x squared. Then we have f sub y. Take the derivative with respect to y, and we get 12y squared. Finally, we have the mixed partial. Take the derivative with respect to y, for example, the derivative with respect to x, and we get negative 4. So that means that our determinant is going to be the product of the two, I guess, not mixed partials, 12 times 12, x squared, y squared, and then we're going to subtract the square of negative 4. So subtract 16. So next step, and yes, these questions really are this long, is to go through one by one and start plugging in our critical points to classify them. D of 0, 0 is equal to 144, 0 squared, 0 squared, minus 16. And that's negative. Since we got a negative determinant, the second derivative test tells us that the point 0, 0 is a saddle point. So it's not quite a local min, nor is it quite a local max. It's sort of a fusion of the two. Let's test the critical point, d of 1, 1, which, plugging in 1 and 1 for x and y, we'll get 144 minus 16, which is definitely positive. Now, this is not enough to classify 1, 1 as anything just yet. Once the determinant has found to be positive, we need to go back and figure out what is the concavity in the x direction. So let's plug in 1, 1 to the second derivative, resulting in 12, 1 squared, which is equal to 12. Because this is positive, and the function is concave up in the x direction, we can conclude that 1, 1 is the location of a local minimum. It's lower than any nearby points. And finally, for minus 1, minus 1, if we plug those points into our determinant, because of the squares, we actually get exactly the same outcome that we got from positive 1, positive 1. So let's go ahead. We got 144 minus 16, positive. Plug that into the second derivative in the x direction. Because of the square, we once again get a positive result. And once again, we conclude that this point is a local minimum. All right, so let's take a deep breath. To find and classify the critical points of that function required us to fill up a page and a half worth of work. And I know my handwriting is a little bit on the big side, but really these questions are that long. And as you go through this course, the questions begin to get more and more involved. So don't necessarily assume automatically that you're doing something wrong if you find yourself in the midst of something that is this involved, because many of these questions are this involved. Now let's go back to GeoGebra and let's see if the graph does agree with what we have calculated. All right. It looks like a pair of pants, actually. I haven't graphed this before, so I'm seeing this for the first time. This looks like a pair of pants. Here at 0, 0 is our saddle point, going up in one direction but down in another direction. And then here, although the bottoms have gotten cut off, we can see our local minima here at negative 1, negative 1, and positive 1, positive 1. Very amusing graph, I would say. Okay. Now that concludes that idea, finding and classifying critical points. And although this video is probably already a bit too long, we still have a bit of work to do in terms of terminology and one more exercise. So just bear with me and stay with us a little bit longer. Talking about absolute maxima and minima. And just as in calculus 1, the absolute maxima is different from the local maxima, Because instead of local maxes having to be larger than any nearby point, absolute maxes have to be larger than every other point in the domain of the function. So if f of ab is larger than f of xy for every point in the domain, we say that f of ab is the absolute maximum value. And if that output happens to be smaller than every other point, then we get the corresponding absolute minimum value. So let's do one final example. Here is a contour map of the function f of xy. Based on the contour map, let's estimate a location of the absolute minimum. Okay, so we have a variety of different level curves drawn here, and my eye is drawn to what appears to be this hole in the middle of the graph. Now, because I don't have an infinite collection of level curves drawn for me here, I really can only make a guess at what is going on in the center of this hole. But if I did have to make a guess, I would imagine that the absolute minimum is in the center of the hole here. Because as you get closer and closer into the hole's center, we can see the z values going down steadily, -1, -3, -5. And anywhere away from this hole, it seems like the z values are larger than that. For example, in this entire blue region here, the z values are up to 20. So based on the contour map, this would be my guess for the absolute minimum value where it is located in the xy plane.